Okay, financing the disaster risk in India. So, in that, what points we'll cover is hazard profile of India, disaster trends in India, a historical perspective, financial arrangements made in our country, and of course, we know few points about Disaster Management Act already, and restructuring the disaster risk finance. So, all these five parts we will cover in this PPT. So, hazard profile of India. Now we have gone through it many times, the vulnerability profile or the hazard profile of India, what is called as. So, the combination of geophysical, hydrometeorological, and anthropogenic conditions prevailing in different regions make India one of the most disaster-prone countries of the globe. Right? So, it is not just because of the man-made reasons, but the combination of geophysical, our location, hydrometeorological, because of the location, the weather, the climatic conditions, and anthropogenic is the man-made reasons. Okay, so they make India more vulnerable or more prone to the disasters. Almost every type of natural or man-made hazard affect one or more parts of India, and about one third of the area suffer from multiple hazards. So that is the disaster profile or hazard profile of India, where see here everything is given. The drought-prone areas are shown by the yellow color. Okay, the pink color shows the hot desert. The green color, wherever it is, it shows the cold desert. The dark blue, I mean these blue lines indicate the flood-prone areas. Okay, and the white parts are the areas affected by cyclonic storm. Okay, and others shown by these dots are the earthquake-prone areas. Then few of the events, major events, we have also seen the number of events when we were talking about the type of disasters in the second module, right? So similarly, there are few of the major disasters that has happened in our country. Just to tell you that how prone our country is to disasters. And here, if you compare globally, so now this data is till 2003, from 1974 to 2003. The number of disasters, the number of, the victims in these disasters have increased a lot in our country. If you globally compare it with this 1974 to 2003 data, here you can see the number of disaster events, okay, our global rank is third. 303 with number of disaster events as 303. Okay, if you see the first is US with 506 as number of disaster events. Second is China with 388 number of disaster events. Okay, so if you rank according to the number of disaster events occurring in the country, our country ranks 3 globally. If you compare with number of victims, okay, number of people affected, number of victims. Okay, so in that, if you see, our country ranks globally second, China ranks first, okay, and third is here Bangladesh. US ranks 42 rank because a lot of it is a developed country, first of all. There are a lot of resources and a lot of things, proper planning in order to deal with the victims, people affected with the disasters, right? Then, if you see here, mean annual victims per 1 lakh population, mean annual victims per 1 lakh population. Okay, so here, if you could see, our country ranks ninth. US again, it's 124 and so. So here, at least in the first 10, again we are there. That is, here also we are affected a lot. And if you see damage in US dollars, US million dollars, okay, so our country ranks fifth. US ranks first. Why? Because the property, it's not just the human, but it's also the property damage, the economic loss, the social development damage, slowing down of the social development, everything that contributes to the damage. Okay, so it's already a developed country, and that is why more of the damage occurs in that country. And similarly, our country ranks around fifth for damage in US dollar, US million dollars, if you compare. Okay. So this is just a comparison, global comparison given to show that how even our country, not just our the other countries of the globe, when you are talking about our country, how badly we are affected with the disasters, be it number of disasters, be it number of victims, be it amount of damage. Then if you talk about earthquakes, now this vulnerability profile, when we were talking about in our previous models, we have seen about how and which areas are more vulnerable to which type of disasters. So this part we will go fast. That is, when you talk about earthquakes, the Himalayas, the longest as also the youngest mountain ranges, is still evolving and adjusting to tectonic movements, with major fault lines located on its west, center, and the east, which resulted in very severe earthquakes in several parts of the Himalayan and the surrounding regions. This makes the entire region covering 14 states located in western and central Himalayas, northeast, and parts of Indo-Gangetic Basin highly prone to earthquake. The entire hilly region are also prone to earthquake-induced landslides. Okay. Then the other seismically active regions of the country include the Kambeh and the Run of Kutch, that is the Gujarat, the western part of the Gujarat, parts of peninsular India and island of Lakshadweep and Andaman and Nicobar Islands. 35 major towns with population of more than 500,000 each are located in seismic zone. You know this, right? In the earthquake part, we had seen about the zones of earthquake. Okay, so they are depending upon the magnitude of the earthquake, right? So they are located in seismic zone 3, 4, and 5. The total population of the town is around 96.46 million. Each of these towns has the potential risk of earthquake with catastrophic, that is, dangerous consequences. Then, as we are more prone to this earthquake, we are also prone to flood disaster. That is, Himalayas is also the home of the largest non-polar glacial deposit in the world, which sustains the Indo-Gangetic Brahmaputra basin with a spread of nearly 2,500 kilometers and a depth ranging to 300 to 600 kilometers. An intricate river system of this basin carry water and silt from a wide catchments through the longest as also the densest of the alluvial plains of the world. Landslides and soil erosion in the hills due to depletion of the forest cover and seismic activities have increased the silt burden on the drainage, reducing the carrying capacity of the river and the dams constructed over the rivers at many places, which spills with moderate to heavy rainfall, causing flood and flash flood at many places. So we know our country is full of rivers, right? But then, because of the deposition of the silt, because of the soil erosion, because of the landslide, depletion of the forest cover, okay, there is increased burden in this carrying capacity of the rivers. Okay, and when many times the dams are also constructed over these rivers, and therefore it disturbs the carrying capacity of the river. And whenever there is heavy rainfall, it leads to flood-like conditions in such areas. Then the country receives an annual precipitation of 400 million hectare meters, of which 75% is received during the 4 months of monsoon, that is June to September, right? And as a result, almost all the rivers carry heavy discharge during this period. The flood hazard is compounded by the problems of sediment deposition, drainage congestion, and synchronization of the river flood with the sea tides in the coastal plains. The area vulnerable to flood is 40 million hectare, and the average area affected by the floods annually is about 8 million hectares. The average annual total damage to crops, houses, public utilities during the period 1953 to 2008 was about 9,720 million rupees. Okay. So similarly, like we are prone to floods, We are prone to earthquakes. We are also prone to cyclones. There is more than 8,000 kilometer of coastline in the east and the west, and its hinterland, that is the behind area, covering a large part of 13 states and union territories, inhabited by nearly people 200 million, face the hazard of tropical cyclones and the associated storm surge and heavy rainfall, both before and after the monsoon. Post-monsoon cyclones are usually more intense both in numbers and their effects. Since the rivers, which are already full with water, cannot carry the excess load of the tidal surge and rain, causing fresh floods in the coastal areas. Right? Even the post-monsoon cyclone. After monsoon, when the rivers are already full with the water, they cannot carry the excess load of increase when there is during the cyclone there is tidal surge, that is increase in the height of the tides. Okay, so they rivers cannot carry more than the capacity of the water, and therefore that is also the effect of the cyclone. Over 58% of the cyclonic storm that develop in the Bay of Bengal approach or cross the east coast in October and November. Only 25% of the storm that develop over the Arabian Sea approach the west coast. In the pre-monsoon season, corresponding figures are 25% over the Arabian Sea and 30% over the Bay of Bengal. So, like cyclone, you have tsunami also. Various areas of our country are prone to tsunamis as well. Tsunamis are large waves generated by sudden movement of the ocean floor. We know that displace a large volume of water. Although usually associated with the earthquake, tsunamis are usually associated following the earthquake actually. Tsunamis can also be triggered by many other types of phenomena. So it's not just because of the earthquake which is responsible for tsunami. Tsunami is also triggered by many other phenomena, that is submarine or terrestrial landslide, volcanic eruptions, explosion, or even bolides, that is asteroid, meteor, comet impacts. Tsunamis have potential to strip beaches, uproot plantation, inundate large inland tract, damaging the life and property in the coastal areas. Indian coastal belt had not recorded many tsunamis in the past. Of course, it is not a frequent occurring phenomena in our country. The earthquake of 1881 and 1941 over the Bay of Bengal had caused some damages in Andaman region, and the earthquake of 1819 and 1845, very, 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 historic time, near the run of Kutch, created rapid movement on water on Arabian Sea. The 1945 Mekrar earthquake of magnitude 18.1 generated tsunami of 12 to 15 meters height, causing some damages in Gulf of Cambay and Mumbai. The Sumatra earthquake on December 2005 caused widespread damage in large parts of Andaman, Nicobar, Tamil Nadu, Pondicherry, Andhra Pradesh, and Kerala. Similarly, you had tsunamis recently that has occurred. So there is this tsunami phenomena, but the frequency is not as much as of the other disasters. Then drought. Like other disasters, our country is again prone to drought disaster as well. So drought is a condition of prolonged shortage of water or moisture significantly below the normal or expected amount in a given region for a specified period. This condition may occur either due to inadequacy of rainfall or lack of irrigation facilities, high temperature, excessive evapotranspiration losses, low soil holding capacity, etc. So drought can be because of various reasons. Indian subcontinent experiences an average rainfall of around 1200 mm, which is much favorable compared to any other country of its size and magnitude. Right? The rainfall that we receive, the average rainfall that we receive in our country is much more as compared to other countries of the world. However, the problem lies in the distribution across the country, ranging from over 10,000 mm at Chirapunji to 8,500 mm in parts of Western Ghats at one end, to around 200 to 350 mm in parts of Western Rajasthan, Gujarat, and other areas. The problem with the rainfall is in our country is the distribution. Various areas get excessive rainfall, more than the required capacity, and various other areas of the country get very, very less rainfall, and therefore we are affected with this drought conditions. Because of the erratic behavior, irregular behavior of the rainfall, the entire low rainfall and the medium rainfall region is vulnerable to drought conditions. Consequently, 68% of roughly two-thirds of the country's arable area is at one time or the other susceptible to drought. There may be drought situation when the overall precipitation in the season is normal, but its uneven distribution over the months creates the adverse condition. If you have proper uniform precipitation throughout the season at all the areas, of course this phenomenon will not occur, but since there is uneven distribution of the rainfall for this 4 months of the season, that is why the drought problem occurs in the areas where there is very, very less rainfall. Then landslides, that is gradual or sudden mass movement of the rock, debris or earth down the mountain slope or river banks, that is called the landslide. Often take place in conjunction with the earthquake and the flood. At times, prolonged rainfall causing heavy landslides block the flow of the river for quite some time, which can cause the havoc to the downstream settlements on its bursting. The hilly terrains of India, of course landslide occurs in the hilly terrains, particularly in the Himalayas and the Western Ghats, are most vulnerable to landslides. The slides are generally in the nature of debris flows occurring mainly during the monsoon, but the effect are felt more acutely due to higher density of population in this region. Scientists have been warning of increasing incidence of landslide due to glacial melts in the higher Himalayas and flash floods in the lower Himalayas. Increase of the heavy rainfall. So here when you talk about landslide, it also includes the avalanche, which is also a type of landslide, right? That is glacial melt. Then increase of heavy rainfall events in the Western Ghats shall similarly trigger more frequent landslides in the region. Like we said, there is unequal distribution of the rainfall where the Western Ghats get huge amount of rainfall. They are also the major reason. Heavy rainfall becomes the major reasons on the Western Ghat for landslides in that area. So like I said, like you have landslide, you have avalanches also. So avalanche is the sliding down of the snow cover on the mountain slope. It occurs due to combination of variety of factors, such inclined slope of the mountain, depth of the snow cover, wind velocity and atmospheric temperature, vibrations caused by the gunfire and strength of resisting forces like vegetation cover of trees and shrubs. All these are the variety of reasons or the factors which are responsible for avalanche. Sorry. When the balance between the gravitational force of the snow cover and the resisting force of the slope and the anchoring effect of the shrubs are lost, avalanche are caused. So this we have seen during the different types of disasters. Avalanche may create various crisis situations for the local administration. For example, road traffic may be blocked and communication links to vital areas may be disrupted. Winter sports may be disturbed. Standing tourists in places with limited facilities and small rivers may be blocked, creating danger of downstream flooding. So these are the major havocs or the crisis situation that is created by avalanche breakdown. Sometimes avalanche may also hit or even bury human settlement down the slopes, such as the Kashmir avalanche of 2005, which killed around 278 people, mostly in their temporary winter hutments. So, this was the frequency of the or the profile of the natural disasters or natural hazards which occur in our country or which is more vulnerable in our country. So, like natural hazards, we also have man-made hazards where our country is prone to this as well. The plethora of natural hazards of India is compounded by man-made hazards of various types. Some of these hazards are so regular and widely dispersed across the territories, such as road accident, infant and maternal mortality, malnutrition, water and air pollution that do not create the sensation of sudden disruption despite the huge loss of lives that these entail. Other such industrial accident, fire, building collapse, road, rail accidents, serial bomb blasts, etc., etc., these are also the man-made hazards which occurs in our country. So they also have all the ingredients of disasters that put considerable stress on the normal administrative and socio-economic mechanism to cope with. Probably the most important is the industrial disasters. The industrial disasters may be caused by chemical, mechanical, civil, electrical, or other process failures in any industrial plant due to accident or negligence, which may cause widespread damage within and outside the plant. Damage caused in the industrial disaster is huge. Damage to property, damage to life, it is huge as compared to the other man-made disasters, of course. Added to this, man-made hazards are the threats of nuclear, biological and chemical disasters, NBC. And now the dangers of pandemics created by avian flu is nothing but the bird flu. Or this, like the swine flu you have, or now the pandemic, another situation of COVID that we have. They also add to this hazards. Almost the entire billion plus people of India are exposed to one or other forms of this natural or man-made hazard, and about one third of them are critically so due to their location in multi-hazard prone areas which face one or more hazards. Okay, so if you look at this vulnerability profile of our country, almost the entire billion plus people of India, entire, are exposed to one or other forms of disaster, natural or man-made. And about one third of them are critically exposed because of their location in the multi-hazard prone area, which area is prone to more than one hazard. Okay, so that was about the hazard profile or vulnerability profile of our country. The part two is disaster trends in India, a historical perspective. So, historical perspective. Previously, what was the perspective related to disaster trends in India? No comprehensive, disaggregated, reliable database on disasters in India was available. The institutional system of payment of ex gratia relief, right? It is given to the people affected. So the institutional system of payment of ex gratia relief assistance, even to the single victim of natural disasters, had been in existence throughout the country since 1990, when the recommendation of the 9th Finance Commission to set up a calamity relief fund was accepted for implementation. The wealth of the data generated by the system have not been captured either at the level of the state or the union government. This is a major constraint which hinders detailed analysis of disaster trends in the country. Considering the data gaps on disaster in India, because just now we had seen there is no proper data, the 11th Finance Commission had recommended that every state should prepare an annual report on natural calamities relating to the preceding financial year, the financial year which has, got completed. Okay, the financial year where the year which has suffered with the different types of disasters. Okay, so like you see in the first slide, what I have shown. Historical perspective, this we are talking about, that previously there was no comprehensive, disaggregated, properly separated data and reliable data about disaster in India. And the method of giving the relief, ex gratia relief assistance, the funds to the victim, okay, it started since 1990, when it was recommended in the 9th Finance Commission. Okay, then there was this 11th Finance Commission. Okay, every year you have this Finance Commission. So the 11th Finance Commission then recommended that every state should prepare an annual report on natural calamities relating to the preceding financial year and submit it to the Union Ministry of Agriculture by 30th September of every year, following which the Ministry of Agriculture will bring out a report on the natural calamities and their management by 31st December of every year. The center's contribution to the CRF, Calamity Relief Fund of a state, due on its 1st November will be released only after this report has been received. So this was the procedure given, okay, in order to raise the fund for this the disasters which are suffered. Okay, so this was given in the 11th Finance Commission. The Union Ministry of Agriculture did devise a format for submission of the annual report by the state, which was reiterated, that is repeatedly modified by the Union Ministry of the Home when the subject of coordination of relief measures in the event of natural calamities other than drought, hailstorm, pest attack or epidemics and man-made disaster was transferred to the Union Ministry of the Home in 2002. Okay, so Union Ministry of Agriculture, which was first responsible to get the report and bring bring out this report for the fundraising. So in 2002, this was given to the Union Ministry of Home. Okay. Then, but very few state, now all the procedure was given that for raising the fund, you have to have made a report at the end of the financial year. It has to be submitted by September end, and that has to be given by 31st December of every year. Okay, and the center contribution of the CRF, that is Calamity Relief Fund, which is due on 1st November, will be released only after the report has been received. So all this planning for raising the fund for the disaster that has been suffered by the state, that was given. But very few state government have actually been submitting the annual report as a prescribed format. But this was not considered a good enough ground for withholding release of central share of second installment as recommended by the 11th and reiterated in the 12th commission. That means very few state were actually submitting the annual report as per the prescribed format given, and therefore there was failure in raising the fund by the or giving out the fund by the center. In the absence of the country-wide disaggregated data on disaster reliance, because if there is no reliable data, there is no proper separated, proper reported, proper reliable data, okay, so there will be problems in receiving the funds. So in the absence of country-wide disaggregated data on disasters release was placed on the database of Center of Research on Epidemiology, that is epidemiology is spread of diseases, meaning, okay, so in the absence of countries wide disaggregated data on disasters reliance was placed on database of the Center for Research on the Epidemiology of Disasters. When there was absence of such proper data, okay, the reliable information, I mean the reliability was on the database that is created by Center for Research on Epidemiology of Disasters. This is good for global comparison but not adequate to capture micro level details for proper analysis of disaster trends. Okay, that is when there was no proper data made or report made, it was dependent on the database that is prepared by Center for Research on Epidemiology of Disasters. But that data from this CRED is not enough. It is not adequate. It could only be used for global comparison, but it is not adequate to capture the micro level details of proper analysis of disaster trends. CRED defines disaster as one in which 10 or more people are killed or 100 or more people are injured. But as per the Calamity Relief Fund norms, even a single person affected by disaster is eligible for relief. Okay, so Calamity Relief Fund, which is raised by the center for the victims of the disaster, it is for even a single person if affected by a disaster. But if the data is not proper, and the reliability is all on the database that is made by CRED, that is Center for Research on Epidemiology of Disaster, it is not sufficient because it defines the disaster as one in which 10 or more people are killed or 100 or more people are injured. So you will not get micro level details about, if at all, about single people who is affected by a disaster. And CRF, that is Calamity Relief Fund, is the fund even for a single person if affected by disaster. Okay, now part 1 we had seen, part 2 we had seen, and part 3 now, this is financial arrangement. Okay, so how is the financial arrangement made for this raising the funds during the disasters? The Constitution of India has not directly specified which level of government is responsible for managing disaster. Neither relief for natural calamities nor disaster management figures anywhere in the Union, State or the concurrent list. Although under Entry 97 of the Union List, a subject that is not specifically mentioned in any of the list would ordinarily have to be dealt by the Union government. Okay, so where the constitution, our constitution, where there was no proper responsibility division given to which level of government will be handling the this disaster, the relief fund and all this. Okay, but according to this under entry of 97 of the Union List, a subject which is not specifically mentioned in any of the lists, like we said, the disaster management was not mentioned anywhere. So it would ordinarily have to be dealt by the Union government. The supportive functions of the central government extends from early warning of the disasters by various agencies like Indian Meteorological Department, Central Water Commission, etc., to deployment of the aircrafts and boats, specialist teams of the armed forces, National Disaster Response Force, etc., arrangements for relief materials and essential commodities, including medical stores, restoration of critical infrastructure facilities, including communication network, and such other assistance as may be required by the affected states to meet the situation effectively. Okay, so that support was given by the central government. Okay, right from the early warnings to the deployment of this, all these things, aircraft, boats, specialist teams, NDRF, restoration of the infrastructure, medical facilities, communication, all this assistance was given by the central government. The expenses that incurred by the agencies of the central government are met and large from the plan and non-plan budget of the central ministries. For example, the Ministry of Home Affairs, as the nodal ministry in charge of disaster management, right, has a budgetary allocation under the account head 2245 relief on account of natural calamities. Okay, so now where you have Ministry of Home Affairs as a nodal ministry in charge of the disaster management has a budgetary allocation for the natural calamities. Similarly, other nodal ministries in charge of specific aspects of disaster management, right, like the Ministry of Agriculture, that is nodal ministry for drought and pest attack, Ministry of Environment and Forest, which is for the industrial and chemical disaster, Department of Atomic Energy, which is for the nuclear disaster, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, which is for the epidemics and pandemic. So similarly, these nodal ministries met their expenses from their respective budgetary sources, which were never the subject of review by the Finance Commission. So now, after, you know, after this historical perspective and after when disaster was given more importance, the budgetary allocations was given to deal with the disasters. The overwhelming expenditure on disaster management in India, more specifically for post-disaster response, relief and rehabilitation. Of course, when you talk about the expenditure on disaster management, the more is on post-disaster phases, that is response, relief and rehabilitation. That expenditure are incurred by the state government and the district administration, and almost the entire budgetary allocation for the same are made by the allocations made to the states annually for the 5 fiscal cycle on the basis of a recommendation made by the Finance Commission, constituted under the Article 280 of the Constitution of India. In fact, the entire system of financing the disaster management in India has evolved around the recommendations of the successive Finance Commission. So you have Finance Commission, like previously we had seen the 9th Finance Commission, the 11th Finance Commission. Okay, so every year, okay, you have this Finance Commission. And this Finance Commission then distributes or allocates the budgetary allocation to the state government to deal with the expenditure of the disaster management. So that is why here the last line is written that the entire system of financing the disaster management in India has evolved around the recommendation of the successive, the next Finance Commissions. Okay. The recommendations of Finance Commission have been based on the overriding principle that financial assistance to the state shall be limited to providing immediate gratuitous relief to the victims of natural calamities and restore the public utilities so that the affected people are able to restart their economic activities again. Okay, so these recommendations of the Finance Commission that we are talking about, they are more targeted towards providing the immediate gratuitous, that is fund relief to the victims, and restore the public utilities so that the social, you know, the economic activities of the society are not affected too much and they restart again. The objective of such assistance, okay, was neither to compensate people for their loss, which is the function of insurance, nor to reconstruct the damaged asset of the pre-disaster conditions, which are expected to be met from the states from their own resources or from the funds available under the various plan schemes of the central government. Okay, so the recommendations or the funds that are given by the Finance Commission, okay, so that is just responsible, that is responsible for providing the immediate relief to the victim and to restore the public utilities so that the affected people can start with the economic activities of the society can be restored. Okay, so for these two aims, for these two targets, the assistance was provided by the Finance Commission. But we know that people want compensation to their loss. That is given by the, that is the work of the insurance. Okay, then reconstruction of the damaged asset to the pre-disaster conditions. Okay, when you know a particular area is prone to disaster, so during the pre-disaster condition, which is called as the preparedness phase, and in that when there is reconstruction of the damaged asset has to be done, so that is expected from the state and the funds given by the state. Okay, and or the funds that are available according to the various schemes of the central government. So that is not the part of the Finance Commission. The relief-centric approach did not encourage strategic thinking on total financial requirement of the state for a holistic management of the disaster. Quantification of the resource gaps and how such gaps can be met over the time by various innovative financial instruments for risk management. The 13th Finance Commission, constituted on the backdrop of the paradigm shift in the disaster management assured by the Disaster Management Act 2005, had the opportunity to look into some of these basic issues of financing the disaster management, which would definitely occupy important space in public policies in the coming year. So every year, when there was this finance commission coming up, there was modifications and more areas were covered. I mean, issues were covered in order to raise the finance for it. Okay. Similarly, when Disaster Management Act came in 2005, which was a complete paradigm shift, what we talk about, that is 360 degree change in the management of the disaster. So at that time, when there was 13th Finance Commission, okay, so this Disaster Management Act 2005 then opened the opportunities for funds through this Finance Commission in various areas of disaster management. So there was this margin money scheme, which is called MMS, margin money scheme. The first Finance Commission, 1950 to 1955, did not make any recommendation regarding the financing of the relief expenditure of the state. Okay, so the first finance scheme had no points for relief expenditure of the state. The second finance commission, which was in 1955 to 1960, took the cognizance of the subject. So every five years you have this finance commission. So the second finance commission took the cognizance of the subject. Their motto was struck by the dislocation caused to the finances of many states by unforcing expenditure of unnatural calamities like famine, droughts, floods, and was impressed with the need for making some regular provisions to meet this type of expenditure. So the second finance commission took these points into consideration, then innovated the concept of margin money to be allocated to the state as a separate fund for meeting the expenses or natural calamities, roughly calculated on the average annual expenditure of the last decade. Okay, the balance fund after meeting the expenses was to be invested in readily marketable government securities so that they may be available when needed, without the states having, except in abnormal circumstances, to curtail other expenditure or approach the union for assistance. In case the expenditure by a state exceeded its margin, okay, so margin money scheme, what it is? That is, according to the second finance commission, which took the points into consideration, okay, that which took the effect of the natural calamities into consideration, they innovated this concept of margin money scheme, which is a separate fund was to be given to the state to meet the expenses of the natural calamities. Okay. And this separate fund was calculated based on the average annual expenditure of the last decade. So it was roughly calculated. Okay. The balance fund after meeting the expenditure, if there was balance fund remaining, okay, it has to be invested in readily marketable government securities so that they may be available when needed, without the states having, except in abnormal circumstances, to curtail other expenditure or approach the union for assistance. This was the time when expenditure was less and the fund received was more. So you had this balance fund. In case the expenditure by the state exceeded its margin, okay, exceeded the fund that was allocated to it, the central assistance to the extent of 75%, central assistance to the extent of 75%, that is 50% as loan and 25% as grant, was made available. See, so this is the margin money scheme, that is margin money awarded by the Finance Commission in crores. Okay, so like it started from the second financial scheme, and you could see here rupees in crores allocated. Roughly, this is not the exact figures, but roughly. Then, like according to the Finance Commission, there was this margin money scheme. So we had seen, we just had seen this word CRF, that is Calamity Relief Fund. So in the ninth financial scheme, so now you saw second financial scheme, which took into consideration about the calamities and their effect. There, this started with the margin money scheme. In the ninth financial scheme, which was for 1990 to 1995, it was asked to review the policy and the arrangement in regard to the financing of the relief expenditure by the state affected by natural calamities, and further examine the feasibility of establishing a national insurance fund to which each state would contribute a percentage of their revenue received. Okay, so that is the ninth financial scheme. It was asked to review the policy and the arrangement in regard to the financing of relief expenditure by the state affected by natural calamities. So it would review the policy and further examine the feasibility of establishing, how feasible it is to establish a national insurance fund to which each state would contribute a percentage of their revenue received. You know, it will be a national insurance fund, which will be again helpful for raising of the fund during such problems. And it would be like, and it would be contributed by each state through certain percentage of their revenue received. The commission made a path-breaking recommendation which completely replaced the existing arrangement of financing the relief expenditure involving the provision of margin money, preparation of the state's memoranda, and visit of the central teams, etc., by a scheme which is qualitatively different in the sense that generous funds are placed at the disposal of the state and they are expected to look after themselves in almost all situations. This scheme was named as Calamity Relief Fund. Okay, so when this, in the ninth financial commission, when this recommendation was made, we will check, they are like checking the feasibility if such national insurance fund would come up, where every state would contribute a percentage of the revenue received and every state will have the access during a calamity. So it was a path-breaking recommendation which completely replaced the existing arrangement. What was the existing arrangement? The MMS, I mean the margin money scheme. Okay, so existing arrangement, which was about the margin money, preparation of the state memoranda, visit of the central teams, all this was replaced, all this existing arrangement was replaced by this recommendation given in the ninth financial scheme about preparing a national insurance, establishing a national insurance fund. Okay, so it was replaced by a scheme which is qualitatively different in the sense that generous funds are placed at the disposal of the state and they are expected to look after themselves in almost all situations. Sorry. So that is contribution by the state for the state, that calamity relief fund, and it will be used by the state during the calamities. So this scheme was named as the Calamity Relief Fund. The salient features of this new scheme are as follows. So this we will see in the next lecture about the salient features. What are the important features of this Calamity Relief Fund, which started from the Ninth Commission and it replaced the existing method which was used for raising the finance. Okay, so this about the Calamity Relief Fund, we will continue with the next lecture.